So very happy to have you here, Professor Joshi. And this would not have happened. I had some 5-6 years ago, I had celebrated Darwin Day in the University of Mumbai. And after that, there was no such opportunity. And this year, I would have forgotten. But thanks to Dr. Sujata Deshpande, she sent me another program's information. And then I said, InstruSen should also have it. Since we have had some courses on evolution with reference to archaeology, of course, but then they were very well taken. Sujata also participated in those courses. And that's how, well, she suggested your name and you are here. Very much thankful to her and you for being here to celebrate Darwin Day with InstruSen. And
it's entirely a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. Thank you. And this will be the first. And I think from next year onwards, we will keep the tradition, Sujata. We do believe in such traditions, which help, you know, breaking traditions in other senses.
Yeah, definitely. It will be great to, you know, keep celebrating Darwin's Day every year, have some programs.
Yeah. So I have requested Dr. Sujata Deshpande to introduce you because she knows you better. I would have just read your CV, and you know that is not really interesting. There has to be some personal touch.
Oh, I'm extremely happy to have sir here and the opportunity to introduce him. It's really great.
She's so happy. You can see her happiness actually. Okay. So I think, are we ready to go live? Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Yes, ma'am, we can start.
Very good.
Ma'am, tell me when to start.
Yeah, I will. Welcome all of you for joining us today. And well, many of you can tell others also to see the Facebook Live or on YouTube, via YouTube. Or is it not the Facebook, Riddhi?
It's only YouTube, ma'am.
It's only YouTube. So you will be able to see, or you can ask other people to see the recording on YouTube. Tomorrow, day after, whenever they can. So over to Dr. Sujata Deshpande. Sujata, I request you to introduce our today's guest speaker, Professor Dr. Amitabh Joshi.
Over to you. Thanks a lot, Mugdha ma'am. And it's a great pleasure to introduce Professor Amitabh Joshi, our today's speaker, to you all. Professor Joshi is a world-renowned evolutionary biologist, and it's a wonderful opportunity that we have him amongst us to celebrate Darwin's Day. So after completing his BSc and MSc from University of Delhi, Professor Joshi did his PhD in evolutionary genetics from Washington State University, Pullman. Then upon completing his postdoctoral studies at University of California, he came back to India. And since 1996, he has been at Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research, or what is known as JNCASR Bangalore. There, his lab has produced many interesting results in the field of evolutionary and population biology and genetics, especially in the field of experimental evolution, which is a unique topic. And his lab has also given many brilliant students who, after completing their PhDs with him, have been doing equally interesting work and establishing their own labs all across India in places like Indian Institute of Science, Education and Research, ISERS, at Pune, Mohali, and so on. Professor Joshi has a long list of honors and awards. I'll just highlight a few to save on time. He is the fellow of all the three science academies of India. He is a fellow at Institute of Advanced Studies, Berlin, since 2001. He is a founding member and fellow of Indian Society of Evolutionary Biologists, which was established in 2018. He is the winner of the prestigious Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in Biological Sciences, 2009, and Lakshmipat Singhania IIM Lucknow National Young Leader Award in Science and Technology, 2010. Very recently, a newly found ant species from Kerala has been named in his honor. That's indeed a great accolade. Professor Joshi is a versatile personality. He is interested in music, likes Bob Dylan, enjoys poetry, and
him Lucknow National Young Leader Award in Science and Technology.
And he himself is a poet who writes verse in Urdu, English, and Persian. I won't take much of your time as you all are eagerly waiting to hear the talk, but just let me say this, that I had the fortune to be his student when I was doing my PhD. I attended his classes on biostatistics, a subject which many, especially biology students, want to keep at bay. And I was perhaps one of them like that, but his teaching was so fantastic that I started understanding the subject, liking the subject. And today, because of his teaching, I have developed the ability to teach that subject to the biology undergraduate students. So let us welcome Professor Amitabh Joshi on today's occasion of Darwin's Day. Sir, over to you. Hello.
My God, has he lost his connectivity one second?
It looks like.
Oh no.
Hi, hello.
No, again he lost his connectivity.
It looks like he has lost his connectivity.
Thank you so much, Sujata. I also have rather fond memories of.
So we cannot hear you properly. It looks like your network is breaking again.
The questions you used to ask. Hello.
Hello, sir, we cannot hear you. I think again it's a network problem.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yes, now yes, but we missed all what you said earlier. And again, it looks like we have lost you.
Can you join us from your mobile phone? Sujata, can you start sharing the PPT?
Yes, yes.
Riddhi, allow her to share screen, please.
I don't have that kind of mobile.
You can share your screen.
Doctor, I have a very, very old.
Dr. Joshi, can you come in through your mobile, please?
Are you able to hear me now?
Yeah, now, yes.
It's not really clear. But can you try through your mobile, please? Maybe the
mobile. Are you able to hear now?
Yeah.
I don't have that kind of a mobile.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
Now it's good.
Can you see the screen? Yeah, okay. So let's start with the.
So let me just say something about the talk before I begin. See, it is with a strange mix of feelings that we approach Darwin Day. On the one hand, as an evolutionary biologist, I'm very happy that we are celebrating Darwin. Sahil Mujabi wrote when the very famous Urdu poet Ghalib's anniversary was being celebrated, and he rather caustically wrote that Ghalib jise kehte ho Urdu hi ka shayar tha Urdu ke sitam khakar Ghalib karam jo hai. You're saying that on the one hand Urdu literature, and yet you are celebrating the anniversary of Ghalib, who was an Urdu poet. And it is a little bit the same with evolution. You know, we celebrate Darwin once a year, but evolution is being relegated to the back of an attempt to make a case for how evolution can, number one, be studied in the laboratory, just like any other area of science. And number two, what is the significance of an evolutionary understanding for us in society today to deal with the many problems that societies around the world, not just here, are facing. Could I have the next slide, please? So the outline of the talk is, in the beginning, I will give you some little glimpses of some of our work on experimental evolution, just to convey the flavor of what kinds of questions we can investigate using experimental systems for evolutionary investigation. And then the second half of the talk, I'll talk about briefly why evolution is central to biology, why it is indeed central to our lives. And finally, I'll also introduce you to some of the great evolutionary biology work done in India over the last 3 to 4 decades, because this is a fact which is not very well known, but most of the absolutely significant contributions to the growth of biological knowledge that have come from India in the last 30, 40, 50 years have come in the area of evolutionary biology, actually. Next slide, please. So let me start by telling a few things about Darwin over and above what is commonly known. We are all familiar that Charles Darwin gave us the idea of natural selection acting largely between individuals within a variety as the reason for adaptive evolution. And I stress the between individuals part because, as you know, the principle of natural selection was discovered almost around the same time by Darwin and Wallace independently. And often people say that, you know, Wallace got a raw deal because he was not as aristocratic and rich as Darwin and so on. But the fact is that Wallace's conception of selection and Darwin's conception of selection were not identical. Darwin emphasized selection to be acting between individuals within a variety. Wallace actually conceived of selection largely acting between varieties, not among individuals within a variety. So there are some differences also between them. And it is the Darwinian, not the Wallacean view of selection that is more popularly accepted and more common today. Second thing that Charles Darwin really did was to get together all the evidence for evolution. In particular, pointing out that the very fact that we can have a taxonomy at all and that we can classify or change. And he particularly common ancestor. So he took the archetype of vertebrates that Richard Owen had talked about and interpreted it as a common ancestral form for all vertebrates. And so the third point, which is often not
Sir, sorry to disturb you, but again, we cannot hear you. Your voice is breaking.
Is Darwin actually reconceptualize heredity. Which is often not appreciated at all by many and moved its center stage in the current time. Heredity was that what is important about heredity is not completely
Sir, we are losing you. We cannot hear you. Mugdha ma'am, can you hear me? Is it a problem on my end or is it the problem on sir's end?
No, ma'am. It is a problem at sir's end because he has left the meeting. He is not there in the meeting.
Oh, okay.
Like when you said for the first time that you couldn't hear him, that time I think he left the meeting.
Okay.
Ma'am, can you call him?
I don't have his number. I think Mukta ma'am has.
Even on his phone number, there is a problem. I tried his number just a while ago and he was not able to hear me.
Okay.
Riddhi, make Dhananjay Karnik also host. He is coming in. He has come in from a different device now.
Okay, ma'am.
Not reachable.
Yeah, it looks like he is having severe net issue.
Severe. What to do?
Ma'am, Dhananjay sir is the co-host now.
Okay. I'm trying his landline now. Hello, sir. What happens?
Hello.
Hello, this is Dr. Karnik speaking.
Yeah, I don't know what is happening. Zoom is hanging again and again.
Yeah, no, your network
Everything else is working. The internet is fine. For some reason, Zoom is getting stuck and hanging.
Can you restart your computer?
Sorry, I can't hear you.
Can you restart your computer?
Maybe ask him to log out of Zoom and log in again.
Log out completely. Log out completely. Hello, can you hear me? Please log out completely and restart your computer and then again sign in.
I'm sorry, I can hardly hear your voice. It's very faint.
Okay, I think. I think then we will, should we, I can't tell him what I want to tell. He can't hear me.
Can you pass on a message as a written message?
He doesn't have WhatsApp.
No, as an SMS maybe.
Okay, I will try that. I have messaged him. Please try logging out completely. Restart.
Yeah.
If this doesn't work, we will cancel it for today.
Okay.
We cannot go on like this, right?
Yeah, I mean, we won't achieve anything.
Two people already in the meeting. I'm sorry, guys.
Yeah, just hold on, people, for some more time. We'll try to sort it out.
Professor Joshi is at Bangalore, and well, the
and his institute is at the outskirts of Bangalore, so I think that is the reason why he is having this problem.
No, but in Bangalore, network is supposed to be very good.
He himself said no, that he conducted the exam and all that, which went on peacefully. And right now, we don't know why it is happening.
We'll wait for five minutes, whatever it takes.
Yeah, maybe 10 more minutes, because if he has to log out completely and log in, it will take time.
Sometimes if there are updates coming in also, you know.
Yes.
Ooh.
Is he back at the meeting?
No, I don't think so. Can't see him. And in SMS, there is no. Maybe he has seen the message. Unless he sends me some reply.
I'm sorry, yeah. Back in the meeting. I've made him the co-host.
Has he come in?
Yes, ma'am. He has come in. I have made him the co-host.
Okay.
Thank you. All this while I have been muted by Zoom. Only now it has unmuted me.
Oh.
For some reason, it said that I am muted and I don't have the permission to unmute myself.
It's okay, ma'am.
So sorry. Am I audible?
You are.
Okay. My apologies to everybody in the audience. I really today, I think the system is misbehaving a lot. So I was just saying that
we have the lost third me. Point.
Sorry, you've lost me again?
Yeah.
No, I can hear. I can
only
hear.
Intermittently.
No, it is coming out very well, Mugda.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Is that my network then?
Yeah, you come here.
Okay. Yeah, please continue.
Okay.
Continue.
Yeah,
please continue.
The third point, which is quite important and relatively unrecognized, is that Darwin reconceptualized heredity and moved it center stage. Prior to Darwin, heredity was a small part of embryology. Darwin pointed out that from an evolutionary perspective, what is important is not the mechanism of heredity, which was unknown at that time, but the fact that as a result of heredity, offspring and parents tend to resemble each other in phenotype, and that is what is crucial for natural selection to operate. And of course, he introduced populational thinking, emphasizing trait variants to be considered one or few at a time, rather than trying to take a overall view of what the organism as a whole is doing. And all of these had a great bearing on our ability to understand the evolutionary process. Next slide, please. Okay, so let me now talk briefly about our experimental system, just that so you get a picture of what it is like. So we work with fruit flies, Drosophila melanogaster mostly, occasionally with other species. And both the little pieces of work I talk about today have to do with a set of four populations called the FEJ. These are populations that have been selected in the laboratory now for over 800 generations to develop very rapidly from egg to adulthood and then reproduce early in adult life, compared to the four populations called JB, which are their ancestral populations, in which all the flies that eclose from the pupa get to breed, and there is a gap of about 10 days between the time they become adults and when they finally give rise to the next generation. So the big difference between FEJ and JB is FEJ, only the first 15% of flies to become adults, the fastest developing flies, are the ones which are collected into these cages and for the breeding population to give rise to next generation. So the adults are kept in these plexiglass cages. Adults will lay eggs on the surface of the food. Next slide, please. And then we pick out little strips of food with roughly 60 to 80 eggs on each strip and place them in glass vials that have about 5 to 6 ml of food in them. And it is in these vials, next slide please, that they like, they will feed and then they become pupae. On the vial on the right, you can see some pupae along the walls of the vial. And eventually adults start coming out into these vials. And when that happens, we put them back into cages to initiate eventually the next generation. Next slide please. So at this point, you can see the vials, the flies from the vials are being put into fresh cages, and then after a couple of days in the case of the FEJ populations, or after about 10 days, 11 days in the case of the ancestral JB populations, the eggs will be collected to start the next generation, and this process goes on and on. Next slide, please. So just to recapitulate what this selection is for, under uncrowded conditions, Drosophila will take about 210-220 hours to become adults from eggs. In JB, in the ancestral control populations, all individuals can eclose and contribute to the breeding pool. And there is about 11 to 12 days of adult life before the eggs are collected to start the next generation for the JB. So the JB generation is 21 days. And from these, the four selected populations, the FEJ, only the first 15% or so of adults to eclose become part of the breeding pool. And the next generation eggs are collected 3 days into adult life rather than 11 or 12 days into adult life. So their generation time is roughly about 10 days. And in all other respects, FEJs and JBs are handled identically. Next slide, please. Okay. So this, you can see the way this works. We have eggs in the vials. Time in days along the arrows. So around 12 days, we get the adults and they are collected into vials. Then they are switched every 2 days into fresh vials and then eventually dumped into the cage. And finally on day 21 from egg, they are again, we collect eggs to start the next generation. By contrast, the selection population, the FEJ populations, they eclose fast because that is what they have been selected for. Only the first 15 to 20% are collected, and then they have only about 3 days of adult life, which is that blue thick bar compared to 11 or 12 days or the thick red bar for the JBs. Next slide, please. So the first little story I want to tell you is about the evolution of a non-optimal life history. So when we talk about life history, what we mean is how long it takes to become sexually mature and how, what is the lifespan after becoming sexually mature, what is the distribution of offspring production during the phase of sexual maturity and reproduction. So just based on what they are being selected for, the FEJs ideally should develop really fast, and then around 3 days of adult life, they should have their maximal fecundity, even if this fecundity comes at the cost of subsequent adult lifespan, because living longer beyond those 3 days will not be of any benefit to them, evolutionarily speaking, We have already collected eggs to start the next generation on the third day of the adult life. So if they could, quote unquote, sacrifice their future lifespan and lay an additional 20 eggs on that day, that would actually be very helpful for their Darwinian fitness. And indeed, over the first 30 generations of the FEJ selection, this is exactly what we saw. So in these graphs, the next few slides will have similar graphs. The white bars are the FEJ, the black bars are the JB, and what is plotted are the mean values averaged over the four replicate populations in each regime, FEJ and JB. So FEJ lifespan, adult lifespan is less than JB's. Their fecundity is actually higher than JB's, the top right graph. Their dry weight on the bottom left has become less than the JB's because they are faster developing. They have less time to feed as larvae and put on weight. And despite the fact that they are not as heavy as the JBs, they are still producing more eggs. So the eggs per unit dry weight, the fourth graph at the bottom right, shows that they are producing more eggs per unit dry weight. This is what you would expect from classic evolutionary thinking, that they are evolving the kind of life history that will give the best Darwinian fitness given what we are selecting them for. Next slide, please. Interestingly, after another 40 generations had passed, when we looked at these traits again around generation 70 of the selection, we found that life history of FEJ seems to have gone in the completely non-optimal direction, which is an apparent paradox because non-optimal life history evolution cannot happen logically under natural selection, all else being equal. So what we find is, if you look at the top right graph first, fecundity has now come down compared to the JBs. Dry weight has decreased even more, bottom left graph. They are becoming even smaller. But more interestingly, eggs per unit dry weight. Not only are they becoming smaller, they are also producing less eggs per unit dry weight. And on the left top graph, if you see their longevity, which has no connection with Darwinian fitness, this selection regime has gone back up to the JB-like levels. So basically, they are not putting all their resources into reproduction early in their life, which they should be. That is what they are being selected for. And their longevity has gone back up, which doesn't make any sense from an evolutionary perspective. So in order to try to explain what might be going on, we came up with a hypothesis, which is illustrated in the next slide. So we know from a lot of other work and also some work in our lab that Drosophila have the ability to switch their resource allocation between fecundity or somatic maintenance and lifespan, such that if they are having a high nutritional status, then they tend to switch resources towards high fecundity, even if it reduces subsequent lifespan. Whereas if they are having low nutritional levels, then they go into they invest more in somatic maintenance and reflected in high lifespan than in fecundity. And fecundity goes low. So this switch as a function of nutritional status is well known in the Drosophila literature. So we hypothesize, next slide, that what has happened is along the bottom of the slide of this axis of lipid, if you look at generation zero on the right, we imagine that there is some threshold lipid level at which the flies switch between high fecundity, low lifespan type of life history to a high lifespan, low fecundity type of life history. And at generation zero, these populations were well to the right of this critical switch level of lipid. In the first 30 generations, of course, the total lipid amounts we hypothesize came down as the FEJs became smaller. But the FEJs were still to the right of the lipid switch. So they were still in the fecundity and low lifespan mode. Sometime between generation 30 and 70, as the FEJs continued to become even more, that
So we have lost you again.
Can you hear me?
Yes, you're back again.
Yeah. I'm so sorry about this.
No, it's okay. Can't help it.
So, in nature, because food levels fluctuate rather unpredictably, it is assumed that a fly which has been well fed as a larva has high lipid levels. When it becomes if it quickly invests all its resources. Reproduction, it has to lay its eggs in the same resource rich patch. And that is why this kind of adaptive switching has evolved. Whereas if the fly was a poor, when it becomes an adult, it might be better to postpone reproduction till it finds a better patch to lay eggs in. But in this case, what has happened is that this, if this hypothesis is correct, then this adaptation from the past has been in the laboratory. So we tried by looking at a few traits. Could I have the next slide, please? So the top left graph is showing on the x-axis the total amount of lipid per fly. And please ignore the day 3, day 10. Just look at the two bars on the left side of the graph. The small bar is the FEJ in white and black is the control. FEJs have much less lipid than their ancestors. The top right graph shows the lipid content as a proportion of dry body weight. And what you can see is that not only FEJs are small and therefore they have less lipid, they have less proportion of lipid in their body. And this is a whole different story why that is so, which we figured out many years later. Actually, in very brief, I'll tell you what happens is, till they are larvae, the FEJs and their controls have the same proportion of lipid in their body. But then the FEJs preferentially burn lipid during metamorphosis because they have to finish metamorphosis very fast. And as a result, when they become adults, they have less proportional lipid. The bottom two graphs actually have the interesting information. On the left is starvation resistance, which is simply the number of hours of starvation it takes before the flies die. And the FEJs take less amount of time to die of starvation than the JBs. This is not at all surprising because they have less lipid. And lipid is well known to be correlated with starvation resistance in insects. But the bottom right graph really is the one that is consistent with the hypothesis. This is starvation resistance per unit lipid. And if you look at the FEJs, per unit lipid, they are resisting starvation far better than the ancestral controls. And this is important because, again, in Drosophila, we know that once lipid is mobilized for reproduction and sent into the ovaries, it cannot be brought back and used to resist starvation. So having high starvation resistance per unit lipid is an indication that lipid has not been mobilized for reproduction, it's being kept in reserve, which is exactly what our hypothesis was. So to cut a long story short, we further verified this, and eventually this today's constraint that arose out of yesterday's adaptation to have this lipid switch, eventually after another 200 generations, the flies actually evolved around it and went back to the optimal life history. Next slide, please. One quick question, Sujata, should I skip one section since we already ended up wasting a lot of time?
I think we have enough time, right, Mukta ma'am? We can still have that section.
Okay, sure. Thank you. So the second little story I want to talk about with the same set of population, so the system is the same, This has to do with sexual conflict and reproductive isolation. So let me just briefly say a couple of words about what sexual conflict actually is in this context. So because of a fundamental asymmetry in that female's Darwinian fitness is limited primarily by the number of expensive eggs she can produce over her lifetime, whereas for males it is easy and cheap to produce sperm in large numbers. So for males, by contrast, their Darwinian fitness is primarily limited by how many females they can inseminate, how many females they can mate with, rather than by resources and egg production. This fundamental asymmetry drives a lot of very interesting biology, especially in species that have potentially multiple mating of females with different males, which is the case in Drosophila. A Drosophila female can mate with many different males and use their sperms, which she stores in her body, to fertilize different proportions of her eggs. Therefore, it becomes very helpful, evolutionarily speaking, if a male after mating can somehow manipulate the reproductive behavior of female to make sure that most of the eggs are fertilized from his sperm, even if after that the female dies quickly. That is not good for the female's Darwinian fitness, but it is excellent for the male's Darwinian fitness. So males in many, many, many species, not just Drosophila, have evolved to secrete various small neuropeptides in their seminal fluid, which go into the female's reproductive tract, get absorbed, and then affect the female's neuroendocrine reproductive system in ways that will benefit the male's fitness, while often they cause harm to the female. This is what is often referred to in the literature as male-induced mate harm or mate harming. Now, because males are injecting chemicals into the female during copulation which harm the female's fitness, if any female has mutant receptors, for example, that don't allow these peptides to bind properly, she will escape those harmful effects and be selectively favored. So females then evolve counter defenses to these little peptides in the seminal fluid. They are called accessory gland proteins. And it gives rise to an evolutionary arms race. Males evolve to manipulate the females. Females evolve to avoid or, you know, resist that manipulation by the males. And this is what is called interlocus sexual conflict. And what we have found, I'll show you a few of the studies later on. What we have basically found that in FEJs, this whole sexual conflict has evolved to settle down at a much lower level than in the JBs. And remember, whenever you have an arms race type situation, all that matters is that both sides in the arms race should have equivalent level of arms. Two countries, both of which have only swords and sticks, are in a balance. Two countries, both of which have nuclear weapons, are in a balance. But when the country with swords and sticks has to fight against the country with nuclear weapons, it will get destroyed very quickly. It will lose. This is exactly what happens with evolutionary arms races also. And I'll show you how we figured this out. Next slide. I think there's one slide before this. Ah, yes. So, on the top here are shown four kinds of matings. Left-hand side is the normal control population, the JB male and JB female. You can see in flies, males are about half the size of females. On the extreme right is the selected population, FEJ male and female. Again, males are about half the size of females. In between are shown the two heterogametic mating. JB male with FEJ female, you can say the JB male is actually bigger than the FEJ female, and a very tiny FEJ male with a JB female in the third plot. You can see that the JB female is almost 3 to 4 times bigger than the little FEJ male. So the two graphs on the bottom, without going into the details of how the experiment is done, what these are showing is that if we mix JB and FEJ males and females together, either in large groups, which is the graph on the left, or one JB male, one JB female, one FEJ male, one FEJ female per container, which is the graph on the right. And what is being plotted is what proportion of total matings comprise of matings of each type. So if there was no problem, everybody had equal chance to mate, all matings are equally successful, all these bars would be at 25%. What you can see here is that one type of mating is not represented in both cases, individual and group assay. JB female into FEJ male. That is the third diagram on the top. Very small male from selected population basically are not able to successfully court and mate with the much larger JB females. So one type of the heterogametic mating basically happens at very low frequency if you mix these two kinds of populations together. The three graphs on the right hand side are showing a different experiment in which all these four combinations, JB male, female, are put together, and the topmost of these three graphs shows one male presented to one female. And what you are plotting on the y-axis is the cumulative female mortality. As time goes by on the x-axis, what proportion of the females die? And in this, what you can see is that one graph is above the other three. Basically, when FEJ males, when FEJ females are mated by the control JB males, females start dying rapidly after that. And this post-mating death increases if you increase the dosage of males. It is male dose dependent. The middle graph is showing for five males, very rapidly death rate rises to 80%. And if you put 10 males, 10 JB males with one FEJ female, within about 40 to 80 hours, 100% of the females are dead. So if you again look at the two graphs on the left hand side, which were showing the proportion of different mating, if you mix FEJ and JB flies together, one type of cross mating, JB female with FEJ male, the mating itself is not happening much. The other type of mating which is happening, FEJ female with JB male, the second black bar from the left, those matings are taking place at good frequency, but females die before they have much chance to lay eggs. So effectively, this is an evidence for partial reproductive isolation between these two populations. When you mix them together, the only matings that really result in progeny being produced in good numbers are FEJ male with FEJ female or JB male with JB female. So this is in some sense the first step of reproductive isolation, and these results are from when this selection of FEJ had been going on for about 370 odd generations. Okay, so there is already evidence for partial reproductive isolation, and it seems to be mediated by reproductive or intersexual conflict, because remember, when ancestral male mates with the very small selected line females, they are dying rapidly after mating, suggesting that they may not have good defenses against the accessory gland proteins produced by the JB males. And that is what we next try to check out. Next slide, please. So this experiment, let me just briefly describe. So here we wanted to control for the size difference between FEJ males and the much larger JB males. So in Drosophila, if you rear the larvae under crowded conditions, they don't get that very good nutrition, then the adult size becomes small. So by imposing crowding on a sample of JB larvae, we can generate JB flies. They are genetically JB flies, but because they have been crowded, they are small sized adults, the same size as FEJ. So we generated these kind of flies and called them as JCs. They are controlled for size. And then what we do is we set up experiments where an FEJ female is given either an FEJ male to mate with, and then we look at mortality over 14 days, or a JB male to mate with, and we look at mortality over 14 days, or a JC male, and then we look at mortality over 14 days. And we do the same for a JB females and for JC females. So the bottom axis, the x-axis is the female type. And the y-axis is the cumulative mortality, fraction of females that died within 14 days after mating, after just one mating. Okay. So as you can see, FEJ females, when they mate with JB males, the big bar in the middle, almost 70% of them die within 40 days of just one mating. When the FEJ female mates with FEJ male, the white bar on the left, hardly 20% death happens. And interestingly, even when they mate with the JC male, which is the small but genetically like JB male, they induce mortality at par with the FEJs. What this suggests is that it is not so much the nature of the accessory gland proteins that are encoded in the JB genome, but the dosage of the accessory gland proteins that is being released in the seminal fluid of the large males when they ejaculate. But if we look at what JC females do, it is very interesting. See, JC females are as small as the FEJ females, but they don't suffer any greater mortality when they mate with the JB males. So the female resistance to being bombarded with these toxic accessory gland proteins is intact in the JC females, presumably because that is genetically coded. It depends on what receptors they have. Are they slightly mutated so that they don't respond that well anymore to the accessory gland proteins of the males from their population? So this clearly suggests that what is happening with the JBs, the JB males killing so many FEJ females, is partly a function of the dose of accessory gland proteins that is happening, and not so much for the females. I should also add that we also did some transcriptomic studies, and if you compare FEJ young males with JB males, in the FEJs, the gene expression level of all the 100 odd accessory gland protein genes is many fold lower than it is in their control population males, which is consistent with this idea. Next slide, please. Okay. So remember here again, the difference was in two aspects between FEJs and JBs. One is FEJs have to develop fast, but they also have to reproduce early in life. They have a shorter effective time from eclosion to reproduction. Next slide, please. Now, this leads to two possibilities. So, what is it about the FEJ selection that is giving rise to this evolution of sexual conflict to lower level? Is it because they are developing fast and therefore small, so they produce less amount of accessory gland proteins and all that, and therefore the females need not maintain their costly defenses? They also evolve to lose their defenses and the whole system stabilizes at a much lower level of conflict. Or could it be that sexual selection is playing a role? Because in the FEJ population, there are only 3 days before eggs are collected for the next generation. So it is likely that there is not much of opportunity for remating by the FEJ females, whereas JB females get about 12 days, so they might be remating multiple times in that process. So here, just the two graphs on the top are the only ones I want to draw your attention to. The bottom we can ignore. This is comparing the lifetime mating rate and courtship rates of JBs and FEJs in the period between their becoming adults and the egg collection for next generation in their setup. And you can see that JBs are mating many more times, or at a much higher rate than the FEJs. Actually, the average number of matings for an FEJ population in its lifetime is just 1.1. For JBs, the average number of matings is a little more than 5. And courtship also, JBs are much more active in courting. So it could very well be that sexual selection is also molding the evolution of lower conflict, there's basically less opportunity for FEJs to experience conflict because most of the time they are mating only once. Next slide, please. So in order to tease this apart, whether it is the early development or the sexual selection, we developed two more kinds of populations from the FEJ. These are so-called relaxed selection populations. So one set of populations, which is the RF. RF populations are relaxed from FEJ selection. So basically, there is no selection for faster development. Everybody that encloses becomes part of the breeding population. And instead of just 2.5 to 3 days before we collect eggs for the next generation, we give them 8 days of breeding time. So they are going back towards the JB type of regime. They are completely relaxed for both the selection for rapid development and for early reproduction. The other reverse selection line, the RRF lines, are relaxed only for the rapid development. So everybody that encloses can actually become part of the breeding pool, but then they have only 3 days of adult life, just like the FEJs. Therefore, RRFs and RFs differ in the level of sexual selection they can undergo. Development part, they have both been relaxed equally, but RFs have more opportunity for sexual selection, RRFs have less opportunity for sexual selection. Next slide, please. This is just to show the differences in the adult breeding duration, which corresponds to the time available for sexual selection. And this will be repeated. This blue, green, black, and red code will be repeated in the next few slides. Next slide, please.
Sir, just for the advantage of many people in the audience, can you just repeat the meaning of JB and RF and RRF?
Okay. So JB has no particular meaning. It is Joshi baseline. They are ancestral to all our population. We have more than 80, 90 populations. These are the first original populations that we have, and they are being maintained in the same way since that time, since a very, very long time.
Okay.
FEJ stood for faster development, early reproduction, derived from JB.
Yes.
RF is relaxed selection FEJ. So both aspects of FEJ selection has been relaxed.
Mm-hmm.
RRF is relaxed only for rapid development, but not for the early reproduction.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
So
Thanks. We want to,
in the next 2-3 slides, we want to focus on comparing RRF and RF. If they become different, that means sexual selection is the cause, because they differ only in the level of sexual selection they can experience.
Okay, yes.
Yeah. Next slide. So this is just to quickly demonstrate that indeed the RRF and RF reverse selection had an effect. After, so what you have on the top panel, across the top, is after some 25 generations of selection. Below is after some 45 generations of reverse selection. Basically, their development time is increasing compared to FEJ as reverse selection proceeds, and their dry weights are also increasing compared to FEJ as the selection proceeds. So they are indeed evolving as a result of the relaxed selection. This is just to establish that. Next slide, please. So now let me bring in another bit of the story. So I've been talking about these accessory gland proteins that are involved. So these are produced by these paired accessory glands that are attached to the testes in Drosophila. And we know that testis size is correlated with sperm competitive ability and therefore sexually selected trait. And also accessory gland size is connected with how much accessory glands you will pump out during the ejaculation at the time of copulation. So these morphological traits of testis size and accessory gland size are used as surrogates for the sort of intensity of sexual conflict and sexual selection a lot in the Drosophila world. And a common surrogate for body size is the thorax length, which is shown in the figure on the left, which you can measure by photographing the place. Next slide, please. So here, what we are looking on the left graph is mating duration. Once they copulate, how long they copulate for. Because again, a lot of previous work with Drosophila has suggested that both the amount of sperm transmitted during the mating and the amount of accessory gland fluid transmitted during the mating is positively correlated with the duration of mating. And both of these are again correlated with sexual conflict. And on the right hand side graph is how long it takes from eclosion, from becoming an adult, up to the first mating. And I'll just point out an interesting fact here. You notice the FEJ flies, the faster developing flies, take much longer on the right hand side graph. They take much longer than the JPEs or the RFs and RRFs to begin mating. Their time from becoming adult to becoming reproductively mature is much longer. And again, this is a very interesting story in its own right. In a nutshell, what is happening in FEJs is they are under pressure to finish their larval stage and pupal stage very quickly. Now, one of the things that takes long time in the pupal stage, particularly for males, is the maturation of the sperms, which happens in the pupa itself, so that they then become quickly reproductively mature when they become adults. In the FEJs, actually, a lot of the sperm maturation and indeed even the gonad maturation is postponed from pupal stage to early adulthood. And that is why they take longer after they become adults to actually become ready to mate. And if we go back to the graph on the left, mating duration of FEJ is much shorter than JB, which is again consistent with lower sexual conflict levels. RRFs and RFs are showing mating durations closer to JB levels. They have reverted back closer to ancestral levels. But more importantly, there is no difference between RRF and RRF between themselves, which suggests that whatever has been going on with the FEJs is perhaps not so much driven by sexual selection, although that would have been our first guess, that it's related to sexual selection. It seems to be driven largely by the body size reduction in the FEJs as a result of the rapid development part of the selection. Next slide, please. This is looking at the accessory gland size. And we are looking at virgin flies before they mate in the black bars, and the gray bars are just after mating. And you can see accessory gland, of course, gets depleted after mating because all the fluid is put out in the ejaculate. Again, what you see is accessory gland size in the FEJs is small compared to JPs. That's not surprising. FEJs themselves are very small also. More interestingly, again, between RF and RRF amongst themselves, there is no difference in accessory gland size. Their body sizes are similar to each other, suggesting that, again, sexual selection is not playing a role in mediating the evolution of accessory gland size in the FEJs. It is the body size part that's playing a major role. And on the right-hand side graph, we are just plotting the accessory gland size scaled by body size. And in that, you can see that actually FEJs are, in fact, slightly higher than the JBs once you scale by body size. And again, that is a long and complicated story. And I'm going to leave this particular story here. This is still ongoing. There is another 1.5 PhD thesis after this work, which have gone into this story. But I will stop it here and move on to the next part of the talk. Next slide, please. Okay. So I'll just say a couple of things about why evolution is central to biology. These are just some quotes, the top quote many of you might have come across. And one could always criticize that by saying, look, Dr. Jansky himself was an evolutionary biologist, so he's praising his own field and trying to appear, make it appear important. So I'll draw your attention to the last quote. This is a quote from Sir Peter Medawar, an immunologist who won the Nobel Prize for his work on major histocompatibility complex in mammals, which is very important for organ transplants. And Medawar, who was not an evolutionary biologist, says something incredibly strong. He says that for a biologist, the alternative to thinking in evolutionary terms is not to think at all. That's an incredibly strong statement. And the reason he is making this statement is, see, basically evolution is not a subdiscipline or a branch of biology. It is a perspective. It is a logical framework within which we interpret all the facts that we have about biological system, whether at molecular level or up to ecosystem level and everything in between. In fact, if you can imagine, imagine chemistry before the periodic table. Right, chemistry before the periodic table was a lot of factual information about different reactions. You mix substance A and substance B, you get an explosion. Mix substance A and substance B, you get some fluorescence. Mix substance A and substance B, you get a white gas, which smells like something. Basically, there was a lot of factual information about how materials interact with each other and no logic to any of it until the periodic table, atomic structure, an atomic theory of why reactions happen came about. So biology without evolution is exactly similar to chemistry without periodic table. Evolution is what provides the logic by which we understand the whole of biology. So that's one point I want to leave you with. Next slide, please. The other is this question of, is there one biology or two? And this is an interesting question. And I'm very happy to note that just a few days ago, some friends and colleagues from the Center for Ecological Sciences have written and published an article in Current Science arguing that there are two biologies and they should be treated as such. So basically, when we think about biology, the study of life, we are asking two very different kinds of questions. One set of questions pertains to how living organisms are living, how they are able to apparently and transiently defy the laws of thermodynamics, albeit in a spatio-temporally defined domain. What are the mechanisms of being alive? This is what one might also call reductionist biology or molecular cellular biology, where the focus is on understanding what goes on inside a cell by which the cell is alive. The second set of questions pertains to what we see in the living world. When we look at the living world, first thing we see is diversity. There are so many kinds of species. Not only there are so many kinds of species, they are arranged in hierarchical patterns of similarity, which, as Darwin pointed out, you know, the fact that you have a taxonomy is why you imagine that maybe they are related to each other by descent. And finally, if we look at these different life forms, they show adaptation. They show that they are somehow suited in terms of their morphology, their anatomy, their biochemistry, their behavior. They are suited to the ecological context in which they lead their lives. So any science that calls itself biology also has to explain the diversity, the relatedness and adaptedness of life forms. Now, the problem is that these two kinds of questions, how are organisms living versus why does diversity structure the way it is structured, these involve very different kinds of studies and indeed very different kinds of thinking. And just as we are used to thinking of physics and chemistry as two different sciences, although they both deal with non-living material or non-living objects, similarly, it actually makes some sense to think of biology as involving these two very different kinds of sciences, the reductionist biology versus what one might call ecology, evolutionary biology, study of behavior, and so on. And the unfortunate problem is that this second kind of biology, which is at least half of biology, is completely neglected in India. And another way of looking at how bizarre this is, see, this doesn't strike us as bizarre. Today, when we think of biology, we think of molecular biology is everything. That's how we explain everything in the world, by molecular biology. But just think about it. When you set out to buy a two-wheeler, what is it that you look for in the two-wheeler to make your decision as to which model of two-wheeler I will purchase? You look at the appearance, the aesthetics, you look at the acceleration, you look at the fuel consumption, is it the economical fuel consumption, you look at braking ability, you look at stability in case you have to brake on a wet monsoon road, the two-wheeler should not skid badly, You look at all these trades, these are all two-wheeler level trades. You don't ask that I will choose my two-wheeler based on the chemistry of how petrol is burnt in the combustion chamber of the engine. You don't ask, I will choose my two-wheeler based on the molecular structure of the polymer out of which the tires are made. Because you realize that at that molecular chemical level, all two-wheelers are basically similar. They all burn, the chemistry of petrol burning is the same in a Royal Enfield or in a Bajaj Chetak. There's no difference. So if you want to understand differences and choose the model that suits you, you will not get any help by looking at these molecular level, chemistry level traits. You need to look at organism level or two-wheeler level traits. And this makes absolute sense to us when we go to buy a two-wheeler. For some reason, when it comes to studying biology, it no longer makes sense to us. And I think this is remarkably ironic. At the molecular level, most living things are almost identical. So if you want to explain the diversity and the nature and details of that diversity, the answer will not be at the molecular level. Mitochondria work the same way in everything. Chloroplast works the same way in every plant. Right? So that is why it's also important to have an organismal view of phenomena in biology in order to explain this second set of questions. Next slide, please. Okay, let me now briefly come to why I claim that evolution is important to addressing many societal problems and just illustrate this with a bunch of books on the top. The leftmost book is Why We Get Sick, The New Science of Darwinian Medicine. Please do Google Darwinian medicine or evolutionary medicine. You will be surprised at how much, at least in many countries of the world, the practice of medicine is changing by bringing in evolutionary insights into it. And most notably and recently in the area of cancer treatment, evolutionary thinking has finally been absorbed by the oncologists and now is significantly altering the way we understand and try to devise treatment methodologies for cancer. Next book is DNA Technology in Forensic Science. You are all familiar with DNA fingerprinting and its use for legal cases for identifying victims or murderers and so on. The point I just want to make is that generating DNA fingerprint is an exercise in molecular genetics. Interpreting the DNA fingerprint data to figure out what is the probability that this guy really was the murderer or not requires a very solid understanding of molecular population genetics theory, which is very much part of evolutionary biology. Third book is Moral Animal, Why We Are the Way We Are, The New Science of Evolutionary Psychology. Again, if you were to Google this, you'll be surprised at how much work is being done in this direction. And very briefly, evolutionary psychology tries to ask the question that what we normally think of as human nature, we say, you know, this is basic human nature. Why is it the way it is? Human nature, like human body structure, is an evolved trait. Why is our human nature the way it is? It's an attempt to understand. Darwin's Spectre is a lovely introduction to all kinds of ways in which evolutionary biology affects our world, including in the last part of the book, there's some very interesting speculative work on the evolution of religious beliefs. Not a specific religious belief, but the whole notion of why we have these supernatural beliefs. The fifth book is Does Aging Stop? And again, the quick answer is yes, it does at very advanced stages. This is a book by two of my mentors. And I'll just say that in the last 30 years, the understanding of aging has undergone a complete revolution thanks to the evolutionary theories about aging. And it again has implications for how we deal with it. Last book on the top is Genetic Mapping, Marker-Assisted Selection. Just to make the point that in agriculture, plant breeding, animal breeding, that is all applied evolutionary biology. We are trying to direct the evolutionary course of our domesticated crops and animals in directions that we think are favorable to us. The picture on the bottom left is just meant to illustrate that a combination of the technological ability to extract DNA from very, very old, tens and 20,000 year old skeletons and so on, and the ability to use our understanding of evolutionary theory, particularly molecular population genetics, to reconstruct the patterns of migration in prehistoric times, before there was any written history. And today we have a much better understanding of how humans came out of Africa, migrated and spread in different parts of the world, including in India. And again, for students out there in the audience, I would really, really recommend you read a book called Early Indians by Tony Joseph, which came out a couple of 2 or 3 years back. It has a beautiful explanation in very simple terms of how we understand the peopling of the Indian subcontinent. And the last picture on the right shows you the kind of data you get from the so-called genome-wide association studies, which are attempts to try to nail down specific genes that might be involved in complex diseases like type 2 diabetes or hypertension and so on, not the simple diseases. And again, to interpret data from GWAS study, to do the study requires knowledge of molecular genetics and genomics. To interpret the data requires non-trivial understanding of the theory of evolutionary genetics. Next slide, please. Actually, you can skip one slide and just go to the second slide. This is just a repetition. I think we can skip this also. We can skip this as well. Let me just jump straight. Okay, so I now like to leave you with little vignettes of some of the great evolutionary work done in India. So in this slide, who the person you see is Professor Raghavendra Gadakkar, with whom actually Dr. Sujata did her PhD. He is one of the world's leading experts on the sociobiology of primitively eusocial wasps. This is his remarkable book on the bottom left, The Social Biology of Propeladia Marginata. And he particularly extended W.D. Hamilton's work on the evolution of altruistic behavior by emphasizing the importance of ecological and demographic factors in addition to just relatedness, which is what Hamilton had emphasized. And so Professor Gadakkar actually came up with a considerably enlarged version of the so-called Hamilton's rule, which was a major advance in how we conceptualize and understand the evolution of altruism. Next slide, please. This is Professor Uma Shankar and Professor Ganeshaya from University of Agricultural Sciences, Bengaluru. They both retired very recently. So both of them were in an agriculture university, so they had a certain mandate. Ganeshaya was in the Department of Plant Breeding and Genetics. Uma Shankar was in Crop Physiology and Soil Science. But on the side, in their spare time, they did remarkable experimental studies and some conceptual work also on evolutionary ecology. In particular, they pioneered in the world, they pioneered the study of parent-offspring conflict in plants. And also, they literally rewrote the paradigm of one of the canonical cases of mutualistic coevolution. Figs and their fig moths. Basically, their work overturned the textbook example of coevolution and showed that it was much more interesting and nuanced than what was commonly believed at that time. Next slide, please. This is Professor Milind Vadve, who till recently was at Indian Institute of Science Education Research, Pune. He is also an accomplished musician, dramatist, and poet in Marathi. He is one of the only people in India who has done work in what one might call evolutionary medicine. This is his book, which was published a few years ago, Doves, Diplomats and Diabetes, a Darwinian interpretation of type 2 diabetes and related disorders. So basically, Dr. Vadve came up with a very different way of looking at why diabetes happens and trying to understand it in an evolutionary ecological context. And what is interesting is that a major part of diabetes is behavioral. It's not just about sugar metabolism. Sugar just happens to be one of the symptoms of diabetes. Most interestingly, it leads to very novel suggestions for intervention in diabetes, which are behavioral, not drug-based, by altering behavioral patterns. And many of these suggestions that came out of his work are now already in controlled clinical trials at the Behavioral Intervention for Lifestyle Disorders, which is established in the Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital and Research Center in Pune. These clinical trials have now been actually going on for a couple of years already, and the initial results are quite encouraging. And this is really, unfortunately, the only example I am aware of evolutionary medicine being done in India. Next slide, please. This is Professor N.G. Prasad from Mysore Mohali. He also works with fruit flies. And in fact, we talked already about sexual selection, sexual conflict, and so on. So I should say that Prasad's group is among the top four or five groups in the world in that field. And his group took the first comprehensive validation in one experimental system of all the interlinked predictions from the theory of sexual selection and genomic level sexual conflict. And they have also provided the first experimental evidence for a long predicted idea that sexual conflict will be a very potent driver of reproductive isolation. Next slide, please. This is Dr. Sutirth Day of Mysore Pune. He studies many things. I'll just focus on one part of his work here, which was done with bacterial populations by his student Shraddha Karve. These were the first ever experimental evolution studies in which the environment fluctuated. Normally, when we study evolution in the lab, we do it in a constant environment to keep things in place. They ask that if bacteria are faced with random fluctuations every generation in pH, in salt concentration, and oxidative stress, how do they evolve? And it turns out that the kind of adaptations these bacteria evolve when they are given random combinations of these three different environmental stresses is very different from how they evolve if you challenge them one stress at a time in a constant manner. Most interestingly, none of the three stresses these bacteria were given involved antibiotics. Yet, the adapted populations also evolved resistance to antibiotics, including antibiotics that they or their ancestors had never been exposed to in their evolutionary history. And this turned out to be because of the evolution of ATP-dependent efflux pump activity, presumably as a generalized stress response, but this provides an interesting example how a rapidly and unpredictably fluctuating environment, which is increasingly what's happening today, can actually give you antibiotic resistance against fourth and fifth generation antibiotics as a byproduct, not because they are actually getting selected for. This is a very interesting piece of work. Next slide, please. This is something I am particularly happy to share. So four of us, Dr. Sutirth Day and Dr. Prasad, who you just saw, my colleague, Professor T.N.C. Vidya at JNC, and myself, we have something called the Foundation of Genetics and Evolution Group, which is an informal association of all four of us. We get together and do research on fundamental conceptual issues in evolutionary biology and how we think about evolution and genetics. I just want to make a couple of points with this slide. This is pretty much the only example in which biologists from India are involved in debates internationally about what you might call the very soul of the subject. Not some fine points of some detailed experiments, but how do we conceptualize evolution? What is the role of heredity in evolution? Fundamental concepts. And one of the papers that we published as part of this group activity actually is still listed as being among the top 5% most discussed papers across all disciplines by Altmetrics. And this is the first non-Western contribution to any fundamental debate about the conceptual core of evolutionary theory. Next slide, please. This is something I'm also very happy to share with you. So this book on the left, which you see, was published last year, 2020. It is called Conceptual Breakthroughs in Evolutionary Ecology. And it basically describes 65 studies, starting from Charles Darwin's work, which constitute major breakthroughs in our understanding of the joint dynamics of ecology and evolution. There is only one non-Western study in this set of 65, and that is a study from our lab, which was published in 2003. That was done when Professor Prasad and Professor Sutirth Day were both still PhD students, and Professor Mallikarjun Shakarath, who you see at the bottom left, was at that time a postdoc working with me. And so this is the only non-Western study that finds a place among the 65 breakthroughs in our understanding of ecology and evolution. And this study pertained to understanding how population stability can evolve as a byproduct of life history evolution. Next slide. Okay, I'm coming close to the end now. This is about experimental evolution, and again, this is something that not many people know. The experimental evolution in the modern sense began with the work of Larry Muller and Michael Rose with Drosophila. In India, already in the 1980s, Professor Ranganath pioneered experimental evolution at Mysore University, even before it was popularly called experimental evolution. The picture on the bottom left is Larry Muller, Sutirth Day, N.G. Prasad, and Michael Rose from left to right. So two of our young experimental evolutionists with the two guys who pretty much founded the modern field. What people don't realize is that more than half of the research groups doing long-term experimental evolution studies in the world are actually in India. I am not aware of any area within biology for which we can say this, except experimental evolution. Just think about it. Can you imagine a statement like almost half the research groups doing serious studies in cancer biology are in India, almost half the research groups doing serious studies in neurobiology are in India, but it's true for experimental evolution. And these are spread over Mysore, Bangalore, Delhi, Pune, Mohali, Berhampur, Bhubaneswar, and Sonipat. Next slide, please. We can skip this. Thank you. So I would just like to very briefly say in concluding one thing. I hope that I have been able to convince you, number one, that evolution is terribly important, not just for academic biology as a research area, but also for solving many societal problems. See, whether it is pandemics, whether it is climate change, whether it is multi-drug resistance in bacteria, all these problems are going to require evolutionary training and understanding to be solved. They are not going to get solved by molecular biology alone. And this is something that we are woefully neglecting in India, which has been exposed during the recent pandemic. One thing that came out very clearly is that we don't have many good epidemiologists in India because we don't train epidemiologists, because we don't train people in ecology and evolution. Epidemiology is basically the ecology and evolution of host parasite coevolution. And we don't really train people in such areas. So we really need to think about that. And the other point I hope I have left you with is that, see, if you are working in, let us say, some frontier, so-called hot area of molecular biology, you are competing with people in the West who have a lot more money and a lot better access to technology and a lot smoother administrative framework for doing science than you will in India. So you are always competing at a disadvantage. And you may not be able to make your mark so dramatically for no fault of your own, because it's not a question of you are not bright or they are brighter. They have more money. They have better resources. In ecology, evolution and behavior, on the other hand, we compete on a level playing field. It's our minds against their minds. There's no technology gap because most of our work, as you would have seen, all the experiments I talked to you about basically involve looking at flies, counting flies, measuring their lifespan. It doesn't require any technology whatsoever. So we are neglecting the one field in which Indians actually really do compete superbly at world level. Indeed, very often I hear these statements at meetings in Delhi, people, big people ask, where are the world leaders in biology from India? And my answer always is, they are there. You are looking in the wrong place. You will not find them in molecular biology. You will find them in ecology and evolutionary biology. So with that, I will conclude. My sincere and deep apologies for all the connection issues and therefore for the talk sort of stretching on beyond the time. Thank you all very much for your patience.
Sir, thanks a lot.
Thank you, Dr. Joshi. It was a very great lecture. Our participants must be enlightened by this lecture. And we look forward for you to do such lectures more often on institution platform. Thank you very much.
Yeah, there are some questions we have.
Please take the questions.
You want to ask?
Yeah. You lost you as soon as you started your video.
Okay.
Sujata, please read out the questions.
Yeah, yes. So one question from Jaikishan Menon is that, could we say both evolutionary biology and behavioral science are strongly interlinked and can reveal great human insights?
Yes, absolutely. Because whenever we look at any organismal phenotype, whether it be behavior or even other than behavior, we also need to understand how it is shaped by evolution in the past and ongoing. Evolution has not stopped. So definitely all organismal biology, behavioral or otherwise, is intimately related to both ecology and evolution, because ecology provides the stage, as Hutchinson famously said, on which the drama of evolution unfolds. So yes, they do go together, and they do give us great insights into why the living world is the way it is.
Okay. Next question.
I got the answer for my question. You can go to Anand Devskar's question.
Yeah. Anand Devskar's question is there any international or national conference being held in India on evolutionary biology?
Yes, interesting question. There have been occasionally such conferences. Sometimes they are not on evolution in general. Sometimes they are on more, slightly more narrowly defined areas, like they are on behavioral ecology or phylogenetics and so on. Most recently in 2019, December, the Indian Society of Evolutionary Biologists had organized an Indo-Swiss conference in Bangalore. And of course, since the last year, things have been a little bit messed up. Very, very recently, in December 2020, the Journal of Genetics, published by the Indian Academy of Sciences, organized a 10-day webinar series on genetics and evolution, at which most of the talks were actually evolutionary biology talks. And all those talks you can find archived in the Indian Academy of Sciences YouTube site. It's called Webinar Series in Genetics and Evolution, sponsored by the Journal of Genetics. There were some fantastic talks across various aspects of evolution and different species, different systems. So yeah, not as much as one would like, but they do happen.
Yeah, the same person has said that it was very nice to hear so much experimental evolutionary research being done in India, and it was inspiring. And he has viewed the same kind of thoughts that we need more efforts for having more epidemiologists. The next question, I think, is from a student, Sanika Rajdeh. She is asking, is there a master's course in life science where one can study evolutionary biology in detail?
I am afraid there is no master's level course in evolutionary biology anywhere in the country. That is why I started off on a somber note by remembering Sahil Ludhianvi and what is happening to and why they are wandering Galip while destroying Urdu. There is no master's level course in evolution. There used to be an integrated PhD in evolutionary and organismal biology in my department. About 4 or 5 years ago, it was abruptly terminated by our then president, who thought it was a waste of time.
That's really sad.
Yes, we are still trying to reinstate it. Mercifully, that gentleman has retired and moved on. So we are now trying to reinstate it.
That's somewhat good news, hope. I think more knowledge about evolutionary biology will lead to more rational thought. Like, people are still stuck in the caste system and
absolutely.
Birth, and they also believe in racism still. They believe in
absolutely.
They are genetically great. They do still believe in eugenics, and you know, there are so many things happening in this name. So
no, indeed. Actually, thank you very much for bringing up this issue. This is very important. I just add a little bit to what you're saying. See, many of these issues about how we think of them as sort of sociological or social issues, but evolution has a lot to do with how we deal with them and think about them, whether it is issues of casteism or racism. Evolution is very much involved in understanding why, you know, the sort of pseudoscience around which racism and casteism is built up doesn't make any sense actually as an evolutionary biologist. Similarly, many aspects of violence in society, you know, why are there certain asymmetries in violence? For example, domestic violence, there are very interesting gender-based asymmetries that are actually make a lot of sense if you look at it from an evolutionary perspective. So many sociological problems also benefit if we take an evolutionary perspective, because then sometimes the prescription of how we tackle them as a society can be very different if we understand their evolutionary origins.
Yes.
Yeah. Mugdha ma'am, I have a couple of questions. May I ask them? I'm asking you because
Please,
the time is
of course,
over.
Of course.
Yeah, sir, one question is that you showed that the matings between FEJ and JB lines, when you have the males and females from these different lines,
mm-hmm.
is there any female choice? Let us say if you give FEJ female the choice between FEJ male and JB male, will they choose?
See, the real answer to that is that we will never know if it was a choice or not. We cannot know actually. All we can know is that when one female is given two different type of males, how often type A male was chosen versus how often type B male was chosen, averaged over many females.
Right.
Now, that could be because female exercised a choice. That might be how we interpret it. But we could also interpret it by saying that some type of males are better able to coerce the female.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know what is going on. All we know is this type of male is more successful finally in getting the mating.
Right. Okay. Okay. And the second question is more a general question. How do we exactly define what is that a certain species or certain organism is adapted? Because we generally assume that if the organism is living in particular environment, that organism is adapted to that environment. But suppose I want to say whether the two species or two organisms living in a particular environment, one is better adapted than the other. Can I do that comparison? How do I define if something is adapted or not?
Okay, that is actually a very deep philosophical question. See, first of all, I am not entirely sure that we should ask such question of two species.
Okay.
Because when we are looking at microevolutionary change to natural selection, we are typically thinking about individuals of the same species. Between species, this classic sense natural selection may or may not be working.
Mm-hmm.
But if they are very similar species, we can sometimes meaningfully talk about it. So there are two things here. One is when we talk about adaptation, it should translate into some superiority that you can measure in terms of survival and subsequent reproduction in that environment. If you can show that one group on an average is leaving more offspring than the other, whether through increased survival or increased reproductive output or both, then you can make the case that it does seem to have a higher level of adaptation than the other.
Okay.
Yes, I think there are so many thanks and appreciations. So instead of reading out to you, Dr. Joshi, I would just thank you for an excellent lecture on behalf of everybody. And thanks, Sujata, once again. Sujata, be with us. Let's do a few more things in this field of evolutionary biology.
Yeah, sure.
Not only
sure.
Professor Joshi, but also with your teacher, Dr. Kadam. Okay,
yes,
that's
definitely.
It. Definitely. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. And
yeah.
Especially thank you to the audience for being patient. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
So please end the meeting.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, see you. Bye.